Is the economy really bouncing back? Well, it's time we take a deeper look. If we accept mainstream media thinking, we might as well believe anything. This, however, is about diving deep into the hundreds and hundreds of statistics. We can be empowered to make educated guesses and not rely on the results they wish us to know. You came here for the truth, so let me unveil that for you. Today, we're going to look at several economic indicators. I got a lot of charts to show you. Got a couple articles as well. Let's begin by taking a look at this. The Hindenburg Omen is stalking near record U.S. stock market. Now, very quickly, going to get through this. Warnings from Wall Street are coming thick and fast as U.S. stocks hit an all-time highs. The latest from Sundial Capital Research has this controversial group of potentially bearish technical signals known as the Hindenburg Omen. This basically tries to tell us that there's a deteriorating breadth in share gains and a jump in the number of individual stocks falling to 52-week lows has triggered a warning flag every day for over a week. Now, I wouldn't put everything into this, but it is something to note. And I always talk about the breadth, and I always talk about this narrowing band of stocks that have risen, but at the same time, we have a whole bunch of them which are at 52-week lows. That should be concerning, and we can't just look at Apple selling a whole bunch of phones and watches to be the entire global economy's engine. It just doesn't work like that. All right, on both the NYSE and the NASDAQ, there have been 8 of these technical patterns over the past 6 sessions, he said, the biggest cluster since 2014 and the third longest stretch in 50 years. Like I said, this isn't everything. We need to be addressing every single indicator. I talked about that in the introduction because it's important to look at not 1 or 2 or 5 or even 10 indicators. We need to look at literally hundreds and hundreds. So if you have the dedication, as I'm sure you do, if you watch this channel, you know how detailed you need to be to understand the patterns that form. Just one of them isn't enough, but it's good to look at. For over a week, warning signs have triggered. You can see the S&P 500 going back in time. And then here, combined NYSE and the NASDAQ Hindenburg omens of the past 6 sessions. So we're looking at this, you know, you can see how they've basically aligned this right here with the red dots. And all I have to say is that this has been not a perfect indicator, but something we should be watching out for. Understand the breadth and how important it is that not just a few stocks pushing the whole market up, but we need to see strength, okay? We need like a strong middle class for a good economy, basically. Looking at the global central bank balance sheet and comparing that to Amazon's share price in log scale, isn't it funny that these two are so correlated? It's unbelievable, particularly since the recession. It's almost perfect. And why? Because all of the central banks decided to print money, and one of the stocks that they buy up is Amazon. That's an absolute fact. That gives confidence to the market, and that can help to increase the price every single year. And that's really been performing very, very well. There's no doubt about that. Global systemically important banks, something I talk about all the time, and we could see that it has come down quite significantly here in this peak of 155 down to about 120 today. And this has been consistently losing out. You could see it's going back into levels that hadn't been since about a year ago, actually more than that now. And so we have to understand what this means. These are the two big to fail banks. The two big to fails were the reason that everything started to unwind and collapse back in 2007, then 2008, and then 2009. Well, what's happening this time? We're witnessing very, very significant weakness here, and the average person is really ignoring it, because the average investor, that is, they're not looking at the global systemically important banks. They're looking at the FANG stocks. They're looking at certain things that are rising. And you can do that, sure, but it's not wise to ignore what's happening outside of those stocks, which are still bullish. You need to look at it all. You can invest in the bullish things. Of course, that's where you want your money. But you need to be looking elsewhere as well. The Central Bank of Turkey increased its benchmark interest rate on Thursday to 24%, a hike of 625 basis points from the previous rate of 17.75%. Now, they were holding off, and it was very surprising to me that they had done this for so long, and this actually went well beyond the expectations. They were thinking maybe 300 or 400 points, and they went to 625 points, which probably won't do much in the long term. But I'm going to show you something here. The chart, immediately as soon as they decided to do this action, the currency strengthened, and it's now about 6 to the US dollar. Interesting to me, because I would have thought, just like Argentina, that this wouldn't last long. Now I'm going to see how it is tomorrow and the day after and the day after. If it's anything like the other emerging market economies, we're going to see this currency doing just as terribly very quickly. Now, the Bank of England, I thought it was hilarious. We have kept the interest rates at 0.75%. We are hearing that the economy is doing well. We're hearing that there is a global recovery. Why is the Bank of England keeping interest rates at 0.75%? You have to explain that to me. If everything is fine, why are interest rates at historic lows? No matter where you look, historic lows, near the lows. And of course, this isn't even in real terms. When we factor it in real terms, we've got a very big problem here. Okay, but this is just the nominal terms. Look at the MSCI Asia Pac Stock Index. This is the worst losing streak they've had since 2002, as well as July 1996. We are witnessing just constant losses coming out of emerging markets and as well as the Asia Pac Stock Index. I'm worried about this because of the contagion effect. You can see it again on this chart in a different form. Just constant losses day after day after day. Of course, this all really stems from the issues going on with China and the fact, number one, the fact that the stock market is down 25%, but also looking at this because of the tariffs and all the issues that are present there, I believe that the other markets are getting a little bit worried. Money is flowing out and into the US. Europe's industrial production, mining and quarrying, manufacturing electricity, gas, steam, and air conditioning supply. Where do you want to start? Because we got Sweden, Italy, Spain, and Germany. And well, you know what? In the last few years, since basically 2013, 2014, certainly it has come up. But look at where it was. I mean, we're at 130 previously, and now today we're at 110. It's still subdued quite significantly, and this is industrial production. And now you could say, well, that things are changing and this and that, but I don't really look at it that way. I like to be able to address things for what they really are. And it's showing me that this is very, very weak. And Europe is really suffering. Their stock markets right now are not doing well. We can see that the interest rates are still rock bottom, and they're printing money and bailing out all corporations with the CSPP program that everybody seems to forget about. This once again is the MSCI Asia Pac Stock Index, just showing you here. It's 200-day moving average, moving below that. And then we have this, foreign currency denominated debt as a percentage of the GDP. Now you wanna look at this, you can see they consider the top four here, Turkey, Hungary, Poland, and Chile, to be vulnerable, but look a little harder. I mean, everybody is in a mess. No matter where you wanna look, it is a problem because these numbers can accelerate very, very rapidly. Okay, they're basically showing us anything over the 50% being vulnerable. But just take Turkey as an example here, an extreme example, where we have an issue that is presented where you have all of this debt, but it could be denominated in your own currency. Is it held offshore? What is the situation? Some countries have it all within themselves in their own country. The debt is there, and it is, I would call it more manageable. It's not manageable, but more manageable. And then we have the case of many other countries like Turkey, where they've got this big problem today, and they're not alone in that. There are several countries which have big problems with debt, both externally in some ways, not in all ways to look at that. There are many, many different levels of this. But I would say that we have to be worried for what could possibly result, and increasing interest rates is not going to be the solution. You need to be able to be more self-sufficient. You need to have great partnerships with other countries, and you need to do trade. You need to get the economy going. That's just the way it is, and that's pretty much all I need to say about that. Very quickly, just want to tell you this. David Tepper, manager of $14 billion in assets, is more uncertain about the stock market due to the trade issues with China. If we do the tariffs on China, that's going to make it a little bit tougher on the market. He thinks that it could drop 5 to 20% if the trade tensions increase. I do believe it will increase, but I mean, only 5 to 20%? This here will have a domino effect. That's what's important, all right? And he's personally taken down his exposure to equities, not sure what's going to happen with the tariffs and so on, all right? They probably took down 30%. 30% of their equities have been sold off. So that's pretty significant for somebody managing $14 billion. So I wanted to bring that to you. I think it's important. I think all of this is important, not just look at the US, not just look at FANG stocks, but to look all around the world and really, really address what's going on. If you found the video informative, please give me a thumbs up. When you give me a thumbs up, it helps to support the channel. So I do appreciate that very much. And if you want the financial education you were not taught in schools, these two books have it all. You can check them out at the link in the description. If you're more interested in the audiobook version, you can get that at themoneygps.com.